Yes guys, so let's start valuation of shares. Now whenever we are talking about valuation of shares, we'll have multiple models to calculate valuation of shares. The first model to calculate valuation of share and the most prominently known is net asset model. Net asset method. This net asset method is also called as breakup value method. Or it can be also called as book value. Or it can also called as intrinsic value. Either you call it as a net assets value per share or breakup value per share or a book value per share or intrinsic value per share. Everything, our calculation method is always the same. Now similarly, I have one more method which is called as yield method. Or they are called as yield-based valuations. In yield-based valuations, what we see is we have two types of yield-based valuations. The first one is called as dividend yield. And the next one is called as earnings yield. This will give us three methods in total so far. And the last method is called as PE model. Now, PE method or PE model, PE is nothing but price earnings ratio. So how do we use the price earnings ratio to identify the PE model? Now let's go with the easiest first. The easiest first is your PE model. Let's talk about this PE model then. For valuation of share, when I'm using a PE model, first understand what does this PE stands for. What is PE standing for? It's a price earnings ratio. So I'm talking about price by earnings. Two comparatives I'm taking. I'm taking the price, I'm taking the earnings. So whenever I'm talking about per share basis, then price per share, we call it as market price per share. Earnings, we call it as earnings per share. What are we trying to calculate? We are trying to calculate value of share. Where is the value of share? It can be denoted by market price per share. So now you tell me, how do you get the formula? Market price per share is equal to, the EPS goes to the other side. So it should be EPS into PE. This is the formula we apply for valuation of shares by PE model. We are just transferring the EPS to the other side. So I'll get market price per share or value per share by PE model is equal to EPS per share, earnings per share into price earnings ratio. Now in a similar way, when I'm going for dividend yield calculations and earning yield calculation, first let's talk about dividend yield. If you remember NRR calculation till now, when we did valuation of goodwill by dividend yield method, we said dividend yield method NRR is equal to dividend per share divided by market price per share into 100. This is what we have written. Now I'll rewrite the formula. What do I need now? I need market price per share when I'm trying to value per share. So if market price per share is going to the other side, NRR to the other side, so I'll get market price per share. NRR is always given as a percentage. I don't have to multiply by 100. So directly I can write it as DPS divided by NRR. Even if you write it as DPS divided by NRR into 100, doesn't make any difference, because NRR is always a percentage. When you're dividing by a percentage, obviously it gets multiplied by 100. So I can simply say market price per share is equal to dividend per share divided by NRR. In the same way, if I want to calculate earnings yield, under earnings yield method, again we add NRR calculation. NRR is equal to EPS by MPS into 100. Again, rewrite the formula for value of share. How do you get? I need market price per share. Market price per share to the other side. So EPS divided by NRR. These are simple formulas to complete three models or three methods for valuation of share. Well, the most important method is your net assets method. So let's touch the net assets method. Now, what are we trying to value? We are trying to value equity share. Now, when I'm trying to get the value of an equity share, I cannot just talk about net assets, because the net assets of an organization are held by all the shareholders. That means a portion of the net assets is belonging to preference, a portion of the net assets belong to equity. So very specifically, when I talk about value per share, I do not relate it to net assets. I'll now call it as net assets attributable to equity shareholders divided by number of equity shares. Now, how do we get this part, net assets attributable to equity shareholders? Let's talk about the numerator. Net assets attributable to equity shareholders. Now, when I'm talking about net assets attributable to equity shareholders, first think about net assets. How do we normally calculate net assets? Assets minus outside liabilities. That will give you net assets. But to get net assets attributable to equity shareholders, I need an extra deduction, that is for preference shareholders. So how do we pass this and formula first one? Start with your assets. Assets always valued at realizable value. Now, if I reduce this by outside liabilities, less outside liabilities valued at, always liabilities should be valued at settlement values. This would give me what is net assets. To specifically get what is the net assets attributable to equity shareholder, I need an extra deduction, less preference share capital and if there is any preference dividend also declared, then I'll deduct even that preference dividend. If this is declared and not paid, if it is already paid, then you don't find preference dividend at all. It's already paid off. So my cash already got reduced from the asset side. So I don't need this preference dividend deduction if it is already paid. Only when it is declared and not paid. And this will give us the answer of net assets attributable to equity shareholders. Now, if you remember, whenever we are talking about calculation of your net assets, we have already discussed this part in valuation of goodwill, where we said few assets are not to be considered, few liabilities are not to be considered, so many things we have seen. Now, there were few assets which I never considered in valuation of capital employed as far as goodwill is concerned. The first thing and the most easiest thing to understand is goodwill. I never used to include goodwill in the net assets because what I am valuing itself is goodwill. So when I am trying to value goodwill, I will definitely not take goodwill as a net asset. But when I am trying to value the share, goodwill is definitely an asset which has to be included as far as your etc. So that is the first one. What is the second one? We never used to consider non-trade investment, saying that it will never determine whether the company enjoys some goodwill or not. But now when I'm trying to value the share, we need to consider even your non-trade investments. So these two are very, very important things. The third one, which we never took, is a preliminary expenses, saying that they do not have any realizable value. Same logic applies even here. Because I'm valuing assets at realizable value, your fictitious assets are always zero. So only two adjustments between a capital employed calculation as far as, you know, your valuation of goodwill is concerned, and net assets calculation as far as equity shareholders is concerned. So very clearly write down. Your assets include goodwill and also non-trade investments. Normally what happens is, whenever we are solving problems on valuation of shares, we always have problems on combination basis. In the sense, you have goodwill valuation and then you have to value a share. So always it's on a combination basis. First let me get the value of goodwill, then I will try to get the value of a share. Let's say you valued goodwill. We have already seen valuation of goodwill, where we calculate average capital employed, then we take your FMP, then the NRR, three determinants, and we used to identify what is the valuation of share. But if I am talking about valuation of an equity share from the valuation of a goodwill. So let's say you have completed goodwill valuation and now you are trying to calculate valuation of share. Then I can also write this way. Net assets attributable to equity shareholders is equal to, guys, this is very important, guys, because we normally see this calculation. Normally it will always get valuation problems of share along with valuation of a goodwill. So when you valued an equity share, you already calculated capital employed. First, always start with terminal capital employed or closing capital employed. What is a closing capital employed? Capital employed is nothing but net assets again. So always start with closing capital employed. There are few assets which I did not include as far as this closing capital employed was concerned in goodwill valuation. So this figure I am directly picking up from goodwill valuation, but to value a share I still have some adjustments to be done. What is the adjustments? The first adjustment which I get is add the value of goodwill that you just valued. Whatever goodwill you just valued, start with that. Then what else should I add? I also have to add your non-trade investments which were earlier deducted or not included in net assets calculation as far as valuation of goodwill was concerned. And this is not sufficient. Once I add these two, what I'll get is only my net assets part. But what do I need? I need net assets attributable to equity shareholders. So from the net assets, deduct your preference share capital and also your preference dividend. Which is declared and not paid. This will give us the answer of net assets attributable to equity shareholders. This is the basic part when I'm talking about numerator. When I'm only talking about numerator, I did not touch the adjustment so far. What is that? I will come to the adjustment, but when I'm talking about the numerator part, these are the adjustments which I normally do. This is a normal calculation. This is a calculation that I will do when there is a valuation of goodwill along with it. When I'm having a valuation of goodwill along with it, anyways, I'll calculate closing capital employed. So I'm starting the answer from there. So you don't have to start again with all assets, all liabilities. Unnecessary. So you can directly start from your terminal capital employed as per goodwill valuation. So this is only the numerator part. We'll see the denominator part as well, number of shares. First take down till here. Yes, guys. Let's get to the denominator part of it now. The denominator is talking about number of equity shares. Now, number of equity shares is a straightforward figure that you can pick up as far as the balance sheet is concerned. So many number of shares are there, I will divide it. But the problem arises when I have two cases. Case one, when I'm talking about partly paid shares. Let's say I have a situation like this. I have 10,000 shares in a company of 10 rupees each, fully paid up. Along with that, I have 8,000 shares of a company, 10 rupees each, only 8 paid up. Now, this is the situation I'm talking about. If all the shares are partly paid up, doesn't make any difference. Directly, I will divide the number of shares. But whenever I have this type of calculation, the total number of shares are actually 18,000. But doesn't make sense if I deduct it, divide it by 18,000, because a share is 8 rupees and another share is 10 rupees. I can't find out what is the exact valuation of a share. So on a reasonable basis, you can say that we can go for an equivalent value, equivalent number of shares. Well and good. But whenever I am talking about such kind of, you know, calculations, when I have fully paid shares as well as partly paid shares which are coexisting, in such situations, I have two ways of solving a problem. Method 1 is I will divide by the entire 18,000. Method 2 is what we just thought. Let's try to calculate equivalent number of shares. Now, when do I use this method 1? When do I use this method 2? This is a very good understanding that we need to have on this. Now, whenever I am talking about a problem having a partly paid up shares, we can make two assumptions. Assumption number one and assumption number two. How do we differentiate between these two assumptions? The assumption number one, we say that we are expecting calls on shares in near future. Then obviously assumption number two should be not expecting calls on shares in near future. Now, how do my calculations change? Now, whenever I am trying to identify the value per share, I have two determinants. One is net assets available to equity shareholders. One is number of equity shares. So, let's talk about net assets available to equity shareholders. You exactly know how to calculate net assets available to equity shareholders. Assets minus outside liabilities will give me net assets. Minus the preference share capital and the unpaid preference dividend, we get net assets available to equity shareholders. But whenever I'm going for assumption number one, in assumption number one, I'll have an extra addition to be done. Add calls on shares. What if the call was already made? If I already made the call and if I already had got the cash, such a cash would have been included in the computation of net asset. So that's what I'm assuming. I'm assuming that anyways, if I'm making a call in the near future, I will be receiving cash. So my net assets of the company will be increasing by the amount of the cash. So I'm increasing the net assets with the amount of calls on shares. But I'm not expecting any calls to be made in near future. I will not make any addition here. So normal calculation as far as what we have seen so far, net assets available to equity shareholders will apply in assumption number 2. Now this is the first part. Then we were talking about the second determinant, number of equity shares. When it comes to number of equity shares, now think about assumption number one. I already included calls and shares. That means all the shares are now fully paid up. So I don't have to really think about anything. When I talk about number of shares, I will consider it irrespective of paid up value. Paid up value is 5, paid up value is 8, paid up value is 10, whatever it is. Ultimately, the number of shares will be the number of shares which is already there, irrespective of their paid up values, because to the extent of the unpaid capital, I am already including it in the net assets as calls on shares. But whenever it comes to assumption number 2, here we have to compulsorily take equivalent number of shares. Now, how do we take equivalent number of shares? The easiest method of calculating number of shares is, if I have to calculate equivalent number of rupees X shares. It can be rupees 10, rupees 8, rupees 7, whatever it is. If I want to calculate equivalent number of rupees X shares, then I will do total paid up capital divided by X. As simple as that. Now, normally if you get a doubt, let's check. Let's say I have 10,000 shares of 10 rupees each. I have 10,000 shares of 10 rupees each, 8 paid up. If you actually calculate equivalent number of shares, this I'll say it is 10,000, and this I'll say is 10,000 into 8 by 10 or 8,000. The total will come up to 18,000. Now if you talk about paid up value, here paid up value is 1 lakh. Here paid up value is 80,000. What is the total paid up value? 1,80,000. Now, if I am talking about rupee X share, so let's say I am talking about rupees 10 share, and directly I will get 18,000. So, best formula to use is this. Use total paid up value divided by X. If I want rupees 5 share, it is total paid up value divided by rupees 5. So, whatever it is, get the value, then you will get what is equivalent number of share. Now when I'm using these two values, one is net assets and number of equity shares, what I will identify is value per share. Value per share, whenever I calculate, the first thing what I get in here are always fully paid shares. Always what I get as value per share after considering this net assets and number of equity shares is always fully paid share value. But I have a 10 rupee share, I have an 8 rupee share, I have a 6 rupee share, I have a 5 rupee share. Then what is the value of 8 rupee share? I can't get the same value. I need to change the valuation per share. So whenever I'm talking about value per share, partly paid up, if I am talking about a partly paid up share, then I will take like this. Fully paid up share minus unpaid capital per share. In a sense, if a 10 rupee share is 20 rupees, then the value of an 8 rupee share is 20 rupees minus unpaid capital. If it is 8 rupees paid up, 2 rupees unpaid. So 20 minus 2, my partly paid up share, 8 rupee share value is 18. But whenever I am talking about this assumption number 2, I can't take the same value. I will take fully paid share multiplied by paid up value divided by face value. Will your answers differ? Compulsory. Take the same example. If I have a 10 rupee share and an 8 rupee share. If a 10 rupee share worth is 20, then an 8 rupee share worth is not 20 minus 2 now. It is 20 into paid up value 8 divided by fully paid share 10. So 20 into 8 by 10 you get 16. Here you would have got 18. Here I am getting 16. So I am taking proportionate valuation here. Obviously your values per share will definitely change. So this is my valuation principle whenever I have partly paid share. Either you solve it using assumption number 1 or you solve it using assumption number 2. Now whatever it is, you need to write the assumption and you need to start solving. Answers can be different. Yeah, answers will definitely be different. Based on each assumption, definitely your answers will change. Got it? So writing the assumption requires is a compulsory thing that you have to do as far as your exam is concerned. So take down, guys. Yes, guys, then what about the case 2? Like I told you, there are two peculiar cases that we observe. Those partly paid shares. Now I'll take shares of different face value itself. Different nominal value shares. Now when I have something like this, 10,000 shares of 10 rupees fully paid up, and I have 10,000 shares of 5 rupees fully paid up. Now, you tell me, does it make any sense if I add calls on shares? If I say 5 rupees is calls on shares, does it make any sense in this? It's a fully paid share. Is not liable to pay any extra rupee on it. So what I'll do is, I'll eliminate this assumption number 1. So the entire problem has to be solved as per assumption number 2. So what do we do? Whenever I have different nominal value shares, I'll always try to calculate only with my equivalent number of shares. My number of shares will now be called as equivalent number of shares. There is no change in the numerator part. Only the denominator, instead of being called as number of shares, will now be called as equivalent number of shares. And the value per share what I get is of a fully paid share. I get only for fully paid share. How do you get partly paid share value? Fully paid share into, not paid up value now, into whatever is the nominal value. Let's say I have found out equivalent shares of 10 rupees each. Then if I got equivalent shares of 10 rupees each, then my value, fully paid share value, will be also 10 rupees share value. If you have to get 5 rupees share value, what do? Into 5 by 10. Take the proportionate valuation. Got it? Similar way, you can calculate equivalent shares of 5 rupees each also. So the value per share will, whatever you get will be 5 rupees share value. If I have to get 10 rupees share value, into 5 by 10. So, into 10 by 5. So whenever you are trying to do such way, you are taking a proportionate valuation. So all you have to do is only the assumption number 2 part. Assumption number 1 will not be considered. So whenever I have shares of different nominal value, then value per share of rupees X fully paid up. You don't know, guys, what is that X? Can be rupees 10, rupees 8, whatever it is. Then I will say your net assets attributable to equity shareholders divided by equivalent number of rupees X shares. Equivalent number of 10 rupees 10 shares, equivalent number of rupees 5 shares, that will be value of rupees X share. Then if I have to calculate value per share of rupees Y fully paid up, then what do? Value per share of rupees X fully paid up into X by Y or Y by X? Into Y by X. This is the value of a partly paid share. So there is fully paid share, this is partly paid share. Always whenever I have different nominal values, do not change the numerator, only change the denominator to equivalent number of shares. If you think that, why do I have to think about assumption number 1? Let's always use assumption number 2 and solve the problems even for your partly paid shares also, no problem. Straightforward, you can forget entire assumption number 1. Solve every problem, be it case 1 or case 2, using equivalent number of shares. No problem. Your answers are absolutely right. But make sure that you are writing an assumption. But if the problem clearly says that the calls will be made in near future, then I cannot go for this assumption number 2. You can't write assumption. Because he clearly gave you the fact that the calls will be made, then I have to go for assumption number 1 again. So it's better you have an idea of both the concepts. But you try to fix whatever you are more comfortable with, so that if there is nothing given in the question, we can go about using that particular method. Got it? So you can pick up this, shares of different nominal value. Yes guys, so that is it for the introduction of valuation of shares. Let's take up a small problem for the introduction concept. Let's understand how these two assumptions actually work. Take the 14th question. From the following data, calculate the net assets value of each category of equity shares of Smith Limited. If the shareholder funds are given to you as 10,000 A equity shares of 100 rupees each, 10,000 B equity shares of 800 rupees each, 80 paid up, and C equity shares of 100 rupees each, 50 paid up. If your retained earnings are 9 lakhs. So, from the given small information, if you have to calculate what is your net assets value per share, now again I have partly paid shares. So, I can take both the assumptions, either the shares, either the calls will be made in near future, or the calls may not be made in near future. Let's try to solve as for both the assumptions. Since it is a simple problem. How do you get net assets attributable to equity shareholders? Net assets can either be given as assets minus outside liabilities, or you can also take it as equity share capital plus reserves. So if I total the equity share capital and reserve, automatically what the value we get is your net assets available to equity shareholders. Now, your denominator will change accordingly, and also your numerator when you are taking the first assumption. So, let's put on adding valuation of share by net assets method. First start with assumption number 1 and 2 and write down the assumptions. Assumption number 1, assuming that the calls will be made in your future. Assumption number 2, calls will not be made in near future. So let's maintain two columns. Assumption number 1. Assumption number 2. What are the necessary things that we have to calculate whenever you are trying to value a share? The first one is the numerator part. Net assets method. What is the numerator? Net assets attributable to equity shareholders. Net assets attributable to equity shareholders. I'll split it between share capital and reserves. Come on, go for the share capital first. I have three types of share capital, A, B, and C. Share capital of A, 10,000 shares of 100 rupees each. How much will be 10,000 shares of 100 rupees each? 10 lakhs. B, 10,000 shares of 80 rupees each, 8 lakhs. And finally, 10,000 shares of 50 rupees each, 5 lakhs. My total share capital is 23 lakhs. What else should I add? Retained earnings. It's clearly given your reserves and surplus. Your reserves and surplus are nothing but your retained earnings. Retained earnings are given to you as 9 lakhs. I can't total it here because as per the assumption number 1, we are assuming that the calls will be made in near future. So we need to add calls and shares only under assumption number 1 column. Assumption number 2 column, nil. How do we add calls and shares? A is already fully paid share, so nothing on calls and shares. Only for B and C we get. B, how much is paid up? 80. How much is unpaid? 20. How many shares? 10,000. If 10,000 shares are paying 20 rupees, then this will become 2 lakhs. Similarly for C, 50 rupees into 10,000 is 5 lakhs. Or total calls on shares is 7 lakhs. My total calls on shares is 7 lakhs. Sufficient for you to identify what is your net assets attributable to equity shareholders. In the first case, it is 39 lakhs. Case 2, it is 32 lakhs. Now, go for the denominator. Next one is number of shares. Now for the first column, when I'm assuming that the calls will be made in near future, I don't have to calculate any equivalent number of shares. We'll directly take the number of shares. ABC total is 30,000. under assumption number 2, we are calculating equivalent number of shares. How do we calculate equivalent number of shares? Let's say I am calculating equivalent number of share of 100 rupees each. Total paid up capital, 23 lakhs divided by 100 rupees. So how much is it? 23,000. How do you got this? Use a star mark to explain what we are doing. 23 lakhs paid up share capital divided by 100. Then I am getting equivalent number of rupees 100 share this is. These two informations are sufficient to give me value per share. Value per share of rupees 100 fully paid up. In the similar way, rupees 80 paid up and also finally rupees 50 paid up. Check. First case, 39 lakhs divided by 30,000, 130. How do we get partly paid shares? When I'm assuming that the calls will be made, we need to deduct the unpaid call. So 80 rupees share will be 130 minus 20, 110. 50 rupees share will be 130 minus 50, 80. $39 lakhs divided by 30,000 is 130. 80 rupees share, deduct 20 rupees. 50 rupees share, deduct 50 rupees. So 130 minus 20 is 110. 130 minus 50 is 80. $139 for 100 rupee share, but here 80 rupee share you cannot deduct 20. It should be into 80 by 100. 50 rupee share will be 139 into 50 by 100. This is 69.5111. That is how we calculate as per two assumptions, assumption number one and assumption number two, when we're trying to identify the value per share. Be careful guys, whenever you're doing valuation of a partly paid share, when I take assumption number one where we are assuming that the calls will be made in near future, the unpaid amount of capital must be deducted from the call, from the fully paid share. But whenever you're assuming that the calls will not be made, we need to take proportionate valuations. Let's get into the next one, 15th. Balance sheet of John Engineering Limited as on 31st December 2009 is given below. There's some valuation he has attached to it, check. So there's a balance sheet there. And the balance sheet has a 10 rupees fully paid share and a 10 rupees 6 paid up share. And also 9% cumulative preference shares. The current cost of fixed assets is 3,700,000. Everything is in thousands anyways. And stock is 1,000,000. Investments could only fetch 100,000. 50% of the debtors are doubtful. Preference dividend was in arrears for 5 years. So find out the intrinsic value per share. Guys, it is in arrears. That means, did you pay? I did not pay. It's an unpaid preference share. So unpaid preference dividend should be deducted in valuation of your net assets. Come on, guys. Go on. Let's try to calculate your value per share on intrinsic value basis. He's clearly given you intrinsic value. Intrinsic value is nothing but net assets. Intrinsic value per share. To calculate this, I will start with net assets. Attributable to equity shareholders. Now I leave it to you. What assumption you want to take? Whatever assumption you want to take, you can write down there. Or if you are comfortable, then let's try to maintain as per both the assumptions. If you are comfortable with it, then we can do as per both the assumptions. But redundant. In exam, what you are supposed to solve is only one. I am taking both. Naming it as 1 and 2. 1 is assuming that the calls will be made. 2 assuming that the calls will not be made. Starting with my assets. The first asset that appears there is fixed assets. I have a current cost. My realizable values are 3,700. All rupees are in thousands. Investments. Point number two. Investments fetched only 100,000. Stock revalued. Thousands. Debtors. 50% doubtful, only consider 50% of value, 200. There cannot be a change in cash in bank. Gandhiji always constant value, 400. P&L debit balance I can't consider. So these are my total value of assets. Then deduct your outside liabilities. There is no settlement values which are altered. You can take book values directly. Creditors are 800. Term loan 1400. Stop it there, then we'll get net assets, then we'll calculate net assets attributable to equity shareholder by deducting preference shares and preference dividend. Total of liabilities is 2200. Total of your assets 5400. Net assets are 4,200. I need net assets attributable to equity shareholders, so an additional deduction less. Less preference share capital and unpaid preference dividend. Preference dividend already paid, I won't touch. Preference share capital is 600. Preference dividend, 4 years, last 5 years in arrears. 9% into 600 into 5 years. 54 into 5 is 270, I guess. You deduct your amount of preference shares and preference dividend, and that will give you net assets attributable to equity shareholders. Under assumption number 1, compulsory add up calls on shares. Not for your second assumption. Only for the first assumption. Rename calls on share net assets attributable to equity shareholders. I'll just write down below. Net assets attributable to equity shareholders. Calculate. This is 2330. Add calls on shares. Under assumption number 1, what are the calls on shares? I have 2 lakh shares of 6 rupees each paid up. I'm writing everything in 1000, so I'll write it as 200 shares. 200 shares into 4 rupees they have to pay. It is 6 rupees already paid up. So they have to just pay 4 rupees per share, 800. So this will become 3130. Under assumption number 2, it will become 2330. So complete solving. You know net assets. What is the next thing that you need? I need to divide it by number of equity shares. Number of equity shares, you have to take equivalent shares for assumption number 2. What is the number of equity shares normally? 3,50,000. I can take that directly under assumption number 1. But assumption number 2, I need to take equivalent number of shares. Guys, I'm writing everything in thousands. I'm sorry. I'll write it as only 350. Yep. Now, what about this? I'll have to add the total paid up share capital. 1500 plus 1200. I'm making it equivalent 10 rupee share. Oh, what I get here is 270. So identify value per share. The first value what I get is rupees 10 fully paid up. $3130 by 350 or $2330 by 270. That is the value per share fully paid up. Answer is 6.66 and 8.629. Now I also have 6 rupees paid up. So rupees 6 paid up share. When I am assuming that the calls will be made in near future, what do I have to do? Minus 4 rupees. 4 rupees unpaid. So 6.66 minus 4 is 2.66. And this one, you have to take proportionate valuation, 8.629 multiplied by 6 by 10. 5.1774 or something. Exam purpose, stick yourself to any one assumption. Stick yourself to any one assumption. You identify what are you more comfortable in it now. Easy. Yes, guys. Let's take up even the 16th one. Has something to do with your yield-based calculations. Very simple calculations, guys. Check. From the following figures, calculate the value of a share of rupees 100 on yield on capital employed basis. So, not earnings yield or dividend yield. Now, this is yield on capital employed. Formula is always the same. And dividend basis, where the market expectation is 12%. Guys, yield on capital basis, you are given profit, you have given capital employed. You can calculate yield on capital. How is yield on capital calculated? Profit divided by capital employed. 88,000 profit on 5,50,000 capital employed is 16%. Yes or no? Check. Yeah, it is 16. Second one, 1,60,000 profit on 8 lakhs is 20%. 2,20,000 profit on 10 lakhs capital is 22%. And 3,75,000 profit on 15 lakhs is 25%. Those are your profit or yield on capital employed percentages. Sir, let's try to calculate now. Put our heading yield-based calculations. Yield-based calculations are simple and regularly asked in exams. He will never give it to you for 16 marks or something, but you can get it for a normal 6 marks. One second, guys. There is a change in the previous answer. 8.94. So 8.94 minus 4 is 4.94. Okay. Yes, guys, yield based calculation. First, let's take up yield on capital employed. Now, plenty of years are there. I just need yield on capital employed divided by NRR. So, what we'll try to do is, let's try to take an average. Okay. So, and if you observe clearly carefully, you will get yield on capital employed like this. Year 2007, 8, 9, 10. My yield on capital employed. First year, 88,000 divided by 5,50,000 is 16%. 1,60,000 on 8 lakh is 20. 2,20,000 on 10 lakh is 22. And the final one is 25. How do you take an average? Average is an increasing trend. So compulsory I have to take for weighted average. So take the weights. Recent year the highest weight. 2010 will get highest. 2007 will get leased. 1, 2, 3, 4. Sum of weights is 10. Yield into weight. 16, 40, 66 and 100. This is 222. So I get average yield 222 by 10, that is equal to 22.2%. We are taking a average of percentages. So average yield is also given as a percentage. Yes guys, come on. Give me the value. Value per share is equal to yield per share by NRR. NRR is given to you? Yes. Yield is given to you? I don't know yield per share. I know yield percentage. What is share value? 100 rupees. It's given in the first line. So how do you get yield per share? Yield is 22.2% on 100 rupees share divided by NRR. What is the market expectation? 12. Can I identify the value per share? Value per share is? Dividend also, weighted average guys. Dividend also increasing trend. Check. Dividend yield. Seven, eight, nine, 10 years. Dividend given as a percentage. 12, 15, 18, 20. This is already given. Again increasing trend. Again use weights. Recent year highest weight. 1, 2, 3, 4 weights. Sum of weights is 10. And weight into dividend. 12, 30, 54, 80, 176. So what is my average dividend? Average dividend percentage is 17.6. 176 divided by 10. How do you identify value per share on dividend yield basis? Value per share is equal to dividend per share divided by NRR. Can you get? I know percentage. I know value per share. I know NRR. So dividend percentage is 17.6 on 100 rupees share. NRR is 12%. 146.67. Yield based calculations are simple, guys. What will irritate is only net assets basis, and net assets basis is the maximum asked for 16 marks.